Hello, I'm Stanley Waddell, pastor of the Woodland Heights Free Will Baptist Church in Martinsville, Virginia. Thank you for choosing to view our telecast today. We're delighted that you're with us today, and we now take you into our morning worship service.
While you're finding your places, your hymnals, 563, just when I need him most. We take this time to thank the church and everyone for their prayers and their support of the Waddell family during their sickness and the death of our dear sister, Sandy Waddell. Please continue to pray and support our pastor and his family during their time of grief. In regards to this, I have a letter to the church given to me on the day of the funeral by Pastor Stanley, and he requested that I read to you this letter this morning. Then it will be posted on the bulletin board in the vestibule. This is dated 8/13/2019. To my dear Woodland Heights family in Christ, let me begin by thanking you for the love, support, care, and all the kindness that you have shown to Sandy and me during the almost 1.5 years. I do not know how we would have made it without your love. As you know, it's been a trying time for many of us in our church family. I need not tell you what Sandy and I have been through because you were always there with us. As you can imagine, my life today is all confused, and I need to return to a sense of normal and to work on getting my health back. Also, losing Sandy, the love of my life for almost 49 years, will take some time to get my life in order. As you remember, when Sandy and I came to be with you as your pastor, I told you that it was my desire to be your pastor until God called me home, and that is still my desire. So with much prayer and consulting with pastor friends, my doctors, and with the approval of our deacons, I asked you to grant me leave from the pulpit now through the month of September, returning the 1st of October, if not before. And he put in parentheses, I will be here for homecoming. I will, however, be available to all of you as your pastor to take care of any needs that you might have. Thank you all for being so understanding. I love you more than you could ever know. In Christ's love, Pastor Stanley. Again, if you didn't understand some of the things I said because of hearing difficulties or other reasons, we'll post this on the bulletin board. You'll be able to read it. Now we already have our hymnals open to number 563. Let's stand together for all those that can and will as we sing Just When I Need Him Most. Just when I need him, Jesus is near. Just when I falter, just when I fear, ready to help me, ready to cheer, just when I need him most, just when I need him most, just when I need him most. Curtis Bryant, if he will, to pray the prayer of invocation.
Heavenly Father, we come to you, Lord, thanking you for this morning. Father, just thanking you for another sunrise. And Lord, it just means so much to us. Father, we come thanking you for our church family.
Yes. And
Father, we just ask for your guidance and your leadership. Now, for every home is represented, Lord, we just ask that you bless them and tend to their needs, Lord, as there is so much sickness round about us and so much trouble.
Yeah.
Be with our pastor as he goes through this time of adjustment. Lord, we just thank you for his leadership, and we just thank you, Father, for the love that we share in. So, God, just lead us now and open our minds and hearts that each and every one here will truly leave this place knowing that it was in your presence.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Good to have each one that's come to be with us this morning. As already mentioned, several of our members are on vacation this week, so this is vacation time right before school starts. Some schools have already started, but let's pray for them as they travel, and the Lord will grant them traveling mercies and a wonderful time of rest and relaxation on their vacation. It's good to have you that have come to be with us this morning, and we trust that the Lord will give you a special blessing for having come this way today. Now let's enjoy our choir as they sing together hymn number 444. If you would like to join in and sing with us, you can remain seated in the congregation as the choir sings together, Blessed Assurance.
Yeah.
Now let's open our hymnals to number 692. Hymn number 692. We'll ask that all that can and will stand together as we sing When We All Get to Heaven.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory.
Thank you.
us some music. We'll ask Brother Harry and Becky Oaks if they will come and present the gospel to us through song. Enjoyed that song this morning. We'll ask Catherine now to come, and she will to join with me, and we have a song to sing for you that's entitled "Just Wait Till You See My Brand New Home." Makes me think of Sandy this morning. She's in her brand new home, and we trust that this will be a blessing to you as we sing together. Wait till you see my brand new home.
If you're awed by this world with all its beauty, many stately mansions daily you may see, but and you will neither if you're no more rich than me. But if your soul will look beyond what man is building, you can see what earthly mortals cannot see. For on the other side of Jordan there's construction on a mansion being built just for me. Just wait till you see my brand new home. Wait till you see its beauty rare. There's nothing down here that can compare. Just wait till you see my brand new home. My heavenly Father's building me, and I'm gonna occupy for free. Just wait till you see my brand new home. My new home will not be set upon foundations that are made by man and will someday pass away. It won't be built where the storms of life can batter, where the storm clouds often hide the light of day. But the cornerstone of God is my foundation, the root of David, Christ the Lord, the coming King. What a welcome and homecoming there await me, and I'm expecting any day to move right in. Just wait till you see my brand new home. When you see its beauty rare, there's nothing down here that can come. Just wait till you see my brand new home. My heavenly Father's building me, and I'm gonna occupy for free. Just wait till you see my brand new home. Just wait till you see my brand new home. When you see its beauty rare, there's nothing down here that can compare. Just wait till you see my brand new home. My heavenly Father's building me, and I'm gonna occupy for free. Just wait till you see my brand new home.
Amen. Well, our speaker this morning, it's my pleasure to announce that his name is Bart Hogg, H-O-G-G-E. He's here with his three daughters and wife. And they're here from the King of Kings Free Will Baptist Church in Forest, Virginia. Brother Brandon Baber is the pastor, of which we all know and have enjoyed his church as being part of our Central Virginia Quarterly Conference. And I'm glad that he has appointed Brother Hogg, who is a preacher and a deacon, he told me this morning. I don't know which one of those are first, but anyway, we're certainly glad to have him, and I know that he's going to bless our hearts with the word of the Lord this morning. So would you all give him a hand clap, saying that you will be praying for him as he comes and brings us a message from the word of the Lord. Brother Bart.
Yes, sir. How y'all doing this morning? Good. Man, we're singing some pretty songs, aren't we? When we all get to heaven, boy, it's going to be a good day, isn't it? Get that new body. Man, I can't wait. I don't know if I'll be much better looking than I am now, but I'm going to get me a new body, that's for sure. We're going to be kind of jumping around the Bible a little bit today. I'm not going to wear your fingers and thumbs out too bad, but... we're going to be in Romans 6 this morning. Romans chapter 6. We're going to be looking at a few verses there, but I say this every time I teach or every time I preach, but this is one of my favorite chapters of the Bible, is Romans 6. The headline of my Bible right here says, Dead to sin, alive to God. This chapter is so powerful, so encouraging to us as believers. The Apostle Paul writes in this chapter right here, and it's dear to my heart because he says that we are no longer slaves to sin. Amen. Hallelujah to that, right? Let's look at a few verses here. Let's read right here in verse 6 of chapter 6. We'll read verse 6 and 7 here. The Bible says, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. For he who has died has been free from sin. Son, I ought to get you shouting right there. The Lord God our Savior, he broke the chains of salvation. He came and died. Died for you, died for me, died for anyone that ever was, ever will be. He died for all of us. The price is paid. The debt is done. By God's grace, through his Son and his Son only, we are set free. That's the only way we can be pardoned. There's no other way. Jesus said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Once we accept Christ, we as believers, we like to call that saved, don't we? Yeah. I always wonder, is so-and-so saved? Has he been saved? You know, that word saved is mentioned 104 times in the Bible. And the word salvation is mentioned throughout the Bible 158 times. The word saved isn't just something us believers come up with and fancy the word up saying saved. It's biblical. But there's a lot of world around us right here. There's a lot of this world that we live in right here. They're confused. They're lost. They don't get it. They're confused about how do you become saved? How do you know Christ? There's a lot of them believe that doing good deeds is going to save you, going to get you to heaven. There's a lot of them believe that being baptized that'll save you. There's a whole lot of them. Being a good person to get you to heaven. How many has heard that before in their life? You hear everybody talk about that. A lot of people believe just going to church, just going to the house of God will save you. But some of my Bible tells me something different. If you look in the Romans right here, in the same book we're in right here, we're not going to turn there, but I'll quote it to you. But Romans chapter 10, verses 9, 10, and 13 says, "If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation." And verse 13 is for all of us, because it says, all, not some, but all who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You're not chosen, you're not any of that stuff. It's for everybody. You have to believe in Christ, you have to believe he died for your sins, was resurrected, confess your sins, ask for forgiveness, Turn from the life you were once living. You were once walking in a life of sin. You accept Christ, you turn, you do about face, and you walk away from that life you was once in. There's no other way. If you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ as your Savior, if you don't know Him as your Savior, you'll die a lost person. You can be dunked every day. You can be baptized, you're squeaky clean. You can do every deed possible there is known to man and still die lost. But once we accept Christ, our life should change, shouldn't it? We're not living for us anymore. We're not living for old me anymore. But we're living to please Christ. That's why you saw us in the Bible, and you hear everybody talk about we're to be Christ-like. We made a decision to turn from sin, as I said earlier. We should be putting Christ first in our life. The old me that once was, is dead, according to that chapter 6 in Romans. We're a new man. This man wants to live for God in my life. We become a new man. We're no longer a slave to sin, as we read there in Romans. A new man. This is what I want to get after today. We are new men. We're new individuals, new persons. So if you turn your Bibles right here for me, if you'll flip some more for me, go to 2 Corinthians. We're going to be in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. And I'm sure this verse is very familiar with you guys. I'll give you some time to turn there. A new man in Christ. 2 Corinthians 5, 17. I'm going to go ahead and read it for you. 2 Corinthians 5, 17 says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things become new." A new man is what we are. If anyone is in Christ, we're a new creation. We're new. A new creation means we've changed. We're brand new. We got to hit the reset button. We got to start over. We aren't the same person we once were. We're all cleaned up. Son, I tell you, you give God your life, He'll clean you from inside out. You cleaned up on the inside, and hopefully you're cleaning up on the outside too. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things become new. If you notice there, when we read in verse 6 here earlier, of Romans 6, Apostle Paul wrote, we should no longer be slaves to sin. We should no longer be slaves to sin. Once we accept Christ, our old self is done away with. Or is it? Is it done away with? Is our old self done away with? It says it right here in 2 Corinthians 5, 17. The old things are passed away. But you know that old man we got that we live with for so long, he doesn't go away easily, does he? He doesn't leave real easy. He doesn't go away without a fight. It's a process. You have to grow in Christ and slowly die to your old person. The chapter we looked at first in Romans, the headline of that chapter, as I said, it should be our life motto. It's what we should be striving to. Dead to sin, alive to Christ. That's our motto as believers. That's what we should be doing. We should be dying more to sin and becoming more alive in Christ. I'm a changed man now that I've accepted Christ. And you should get convicted about your sin. And you want to make changes in your life to please God. It's not about living for me and what I want, but what Christ wants. He comes first in my life now. We're all a new creation. We're a new man now. We know that's the way we should live. We understand that. As plain as can see right here in these verses. We know that's the way we should live, don't we? But after we accept Christ, son, a lot of times that fire starts fading a little bit, doesn't it? Starts going away sometimes. You're on fire at first to show people how you changed. You're making changes in your life. People can see when people get right. But after a while, that old me comes back around a little bit. We know we should be striving to die to sin and become more alive to Christ, but a lot of times in our life we get weak, don't we? We get down. A lot of times we give in, don't we? And that old self, that old fella, that old man comes back for a visit sometimes. Before you know it, he's... Hey! Remember me? It's the old fella. You remember me? Man, we had some good times together, didn't we? I know you're a Christian now and everything, but, you know, just mean you hang out like we used to. It's not going to hurt anything. Just one little sin, it's not going to bother anything. Come on, man, it'll be fun. And as time goes on, a lot of times you start creeping. We've all seen it. We've all lived it. If you're here this morning, you've lived it. You start creeping a little. You start creeping a little more. Some believers creep some. Some believers creep a lot. It's the way we're wired. It's the way we are. We're not perfect. We're nothing but sinners saved by grace. That's all we are. Once you're saved, your heart belongs to Christ. But that fleshly, sinly body that we have, son, it wants to sin. And it's a battle. No one ever had to teach anybody how to sin, did they? Nobody. You were born in it. It's a battle to let things die and become new. But being a Christian doesn't make you sinless. But it should make you sin less. That's why it's so important. That is why it's so important to draw closer and closer and closer to Christ every day. He's the only way we win that battle. He is our strength. He is our rock. He is our salvation. There is no other way but to draw close to God to win that battle. You have to keep your fire stoked with the right wood. Son, that might sound a little country to you, but that's where I'm from. You got to stoke that fire with the right wood. And whichever fire you feed the most, let me tell you, that's the one that's going to burn hotter. That's the one that's going to burn hotter. Is it Christ you're going to stoke the wood upon and grow stronger in? Is it sin you're going to stoke your wood upon and grow stronger in? You got to stoke the right fire. Because you can rest assured, you can take us to the bank, that that old self is going to be coming around knocking at your door sometime. He's going to knock at your door. And if you're not growing, and if you're not making changes in your life, that old man, it won't be long, he'll be back in there. He'll come right on in there. And the more you answer the door for that old man, eventually he just quits knocking. He just comes right on in. Comes right on in, makes himself at home. He comes and goes as he pleases. You have to make the decision to grow into this new man daily. We as humans, we're creatures of habit. Would you agree with that? We're very much creatures of habit. The new man, this new creation, it can't happen overnight. It's impossible to happen overnight. It's not magical. It's not a poof, and you're a new man. But the more decisions you make to please Christ and grow in Him, you become that new man slowly. And after a while, you get stronger and stronger and stronger. The closer you draw to Christ, the stronger you're going to get. And when that old man, he comes knocking at that door again, you know, you hadn't seen him in a while, and he comes knocking at that door again. Hey, it's me again. We kind of look out the window at him a little bit. See who's at the door. We start treating him like an old salesman. Like somebody that owes us money, son. We ain't even going to listen to him. We ain't even going to go to the door and see who it is. Let that old man just keep knocking. Let him beat his fist off the door. Let him keep on knocking. You can holler at him and say, go away. I'm not that person anymore. I'm not that man anymore, old man. I'm a new creature. I'm a new creation in God. And I'm standing firm on the word of God. That's what you got to do. And the more you turn away from your old self, and the more you turn into a new life with Christ being the center of it, you have to set boundaries in your life to grow. You have to set boundaries in life to grow against sin. As I said before, becoming a Christian doesn't make you sinless. It's impossible. We're born expert sinners. But you have to learn to grow in Christ. He's your conqueror. It's a growing process. I got one more place I want you to turn here. And we're going to do some reading here. Turn to Ephesians chapter 4, if you would. I know I got you flipping back and forth there. Ephesians chapter 4. This right here. Ephesians chapter 4. And this book right here is your guideline for your new man. This is your handbook. You stand on this chapter right here and live by it. I'm going to be reading Ephesians chapter 4. Verses 22, and we're going to read into chapter 5 to verse 7. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22 says, "That you put off concerning your former conduct, the old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man which was created according to God, in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, putting away lying, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need. Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may be impart grace to the hearers, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as Christ forgave you. Therefore, be imitators of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also loved us, and given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. But fornication and all uncleanness, covetousness, let not even be named among you, as it is not fitting for saints. Neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving thanks. For this you know, that no fornicator, unclean spirit, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. And let no one deceive you with your empty words, for because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not be partakers with them." That right there is a whole lot to chew on. That's a pile to chew on right there. That's your handbook for your new Christian life. That ought to be easy to keep, shouldn't it? If you read 22 and 24 again, it says that you put off concerning your former conduct, the old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man which was created according to God in his true righteousness and holiness. That should be our daily routine right there. Put on the new man. Be renewed in the spirit. What's it say? Does it say be renewed in the spirit on Sundays? Does it say be renewed in the spirit every 2 weeks or every month? It says be renewed in the spirit daily. Daily you have to get up and decide, I'm going to put this new man on. I'm going to put it on. You don't just put your Sunday suit on, son, and take it back off. You got to decide to put it on. Be renewed daily in the spirit. And being renewed daily in the spirit is confessing and getting a clean slate. That's where you grow. I pray God. I pray daily. I have to pray daily. I have to pray daily and ask God to cleanse me, to cleanse my slate. There's some sort of sin in my heart. I know there is. And I ask God to forgive me of it. You have to. So I'm going to ask you guys this morning, church, when's the last time you cleansed your heart? When's the last time you got alone with God and confessed your sins to him? That's the only way to grow. Confession is the only one that tips the cup over. That's it. Your heart's full. And tip that cup over and get rid of some of that stuff and let God take over some of it. You've got to tip a cup over. There's no other way. We have to keep putting on the new man. If we constantly put on the new man daily, then we're going to do what verse 27 says. And that says, nor give place to the devil. We can't give the devil a chance. That doorbell's ringing, an old self, and the devil's standing there with him. I promise you that. Doorbell's ringing, door's knocking. The old man wants to come in. You just don't even answer the door. Don't come in there. Don't let him in there. We don't want anything to do with any, neither one of them. We don't want anything they got. Just go away. It's the best way to stand on it. Tell them I'm done with that life anymore. I don't live that life anymore. You're not welcome here. This new man sticking in his handbook right here. This is what I'm going to stand on right here. If you go down through these verses right here, and I'm going to abbreviate some of this, but if you look at verse 25, it says, I'm done lying. I'm speaking the truth. And if you look at verse 26, it says, I'm not getting angry and blowing up anymore and acting crazy. Verse 26 also says, I'm not holding grudges against anyone. Verse 28 says, I'm not stealing anymore. I'm not stealing from anybody. Instead, I'm going to give to others in need. Verse 29, I'm not saying these words anymore that I shouldn't. I'm not letting them come out of my mouth anymore. Instead, I'm going to speak words of encouragement to others. I'm going to lift them up instead of putting them down, in verse 29. Verse 30 says, I'm not going to say or do anything that displeases the Lord. Verse 31, I'm not going to be bitter. I'm not going to let bitterness take hold of my life anymore. I'm not going to talk bad about others anymore. I'm not going to backbite anymore. I'm not focusing on the man anymore, but I'm only focusing on Christ and Him only. I'm going to be kind-hearted. I'm going to be compassionate in verse 32. I'm going to forgive them when they do wrong to me. If you do all that right there, you're living by verse 27. You are not giving the devil a place. You're not doing it. You can't give the devil and the old self a chance. They are everything I don't want to be. And they're everything you should want to be also. The old things, the old way of life, are passed away. Verse 1 in chapter 5 says, I'm going to be, verse 1 in chapter 5 says, therefore be imitators of God. Therefore be imitators of God. Our goals, our life goals, us as Christians, our life should scream Christ. Our life should imitate God. You shouldn't be shocked to find out if somebody's a Christian or not. All this one half, everything we just went over right here about the new man and growing and learning in this handbook, it doesn't happen overnight, like I said before. It absolutely cannot happen overnight. It's a daily decision to put on this new man, to stand on it. We have to be growing daily in our walk with Christ. The more you put on that new man we're talking about here, the more that old man dies. We don't have to be taught to live in sin. We're born at it, and we're experts at it. But what we do have to learn how to do, what we do have to learn how to do as believers, we have to learn to grow away from our old self. We have to learn to grow into a new creation. The debt's paid. We have to learn to live it. We become this new man as we make changes in our walk. Back to Romans 6:4, and I'll read this to you. You don't have to keep flipping back here. But Romans chapter 6 and verse 4, I'll read this to you. Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should also walk and newness of life. Our sin, our old self, was buried. It's buried once you accept Christ. A new man was raised. We're a new man raised from the dead. We were dead sinners. Just as Christ was raised by the glory of the Father, we also should walk in the newness of life every day, knowing that this battle has been won by Christ, and that's the only way we can ever get rid of the old self. We'll go back to chapter 5 here in Ephesians in verse 1 and 2 about being imitators of God. And we should walk in love as Christ. If we are a new man and walking in the newness of life, if we are imitators of God and becoming more Christ-like, and we know that Christ is none of the following verses in chapter 5 of 3 and 5 when it says, "But fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness let not even be named among you as fitting for saints. Neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. For this you know, that no fornicator, unclean person, nor covetous man, or who is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ." Christ is none of those things. To be Christ-like is nothing like that. Verse 7 just plainly states, do not even be partakers of it. It all goes together. You've got to sustain from it. So I'm going to tell you, sin is like fire. You can't fool with it. You can't touch it without being burned. Either way you look at it, you cannot flirt with it whatsoever. And I've said this before many times. I said this in a sermon back a couple months ago that, you know, you might not be serious about that sin you're flirting with, but that sin, it sure is serious about you. It won't you. You got to sustain from it. We have to decide to put on that new man. We have to put on that new man every single day. So I asked you this morning, church, and we're coming to a close here. We're getting close here. But I want to ask you this morning, that when's the last time you let your old self come back? When's the last time that you confessed? When's the last time you stood your ground as a new believer or as an older believer, either one, and decided that you didn't want that old man to come back in? I challenge you this morning to search your heart. As David said, "Search my heart, Father, and know it." I ask you this morning to search your heart, to confess your sins, to tip that cup over and get things right. It's the only way you're going to grow. That's all I have for you today.
Open our hymnals to number 272. If you felt the call and the charge for anything in your life, I'll offer something this morning. I'm sure our brother will pray for you as you come to take care of whatever problem might be in your life. Only trust him. Stand together as we sing. 272.
Every soul by sin oppressed has mercy with the Lord, and he will surely give you rest by trusting in his word. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him.
Appreciate that good message this morning, and you and your family that's come down from Lynchburg area to visit with us, and we trust we'll be able to have you back again soon. God bless you and your family and your church. Amen.
Thank you for viewing our program today, and I trust that it's been a blessing to you and your family. If this program has been a blessing to you, please drop us a note at Woodland Heights Free Will Baptist Church, 1995 Old Chatham Road, here in Martinsville, Virginia, 24112. Or better yet, why don't you come and visit with us at one of our services? Thank you, and may God bless you.
Woodland Heights Free Will Baptist Church is located at 1995 Old Chatham Road in Martinsville. Service time, Sunday school at 10 a.m., Sunday morning worship at 11 a.m., Sunday evening service at 6 p.m., and Wednesday evening service at 7 p.m. Visit us on the web at woodlandheightsfwb.org. The pastor is Stanley Waddell. No part of this broadcast may be reproduced in any form or by any means without the prior written permission of Woodland Heights Free Will Baptist Church. Any broadcast, reproduction, or other use of the pictures and accounts of this program without the express written consent of Woodland Heights Free Will Baptist Church is prohibited.